सरस्वती व्यासं ततो जयमुदीर My millions of humble obeisances in the Lord's feet of my Paramaradhyatam Guru Pad Padma Om Vishnu Parsis Mad Bhakti Pragyan Keshav Goswami And same millions of Dandat Pranati in the Lord's feet of my Shiksha Guru Om Vishnu Parsis Mad Bhakti Vedan Swami We today observe the birthday of our Param Guru Om Vishnu Parsismat Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Goswami Prabhupada and also disappearance day of Param Pujyapad Shri Shri Gaur Govinda Maharaj. I want that some speakers, those who have some link and they know something, they should glorify their life, history and teaching. So I am requesting first Raghunath Bhatt to glorify his Gurudev. Shri Gaur Govinda Maharaj, you should come forward. You can come here.
So many drops here.
Why?
If it falls over, then it falls on you.
Om Agnata Brahmasya Gnanjana Shalakaya Chakshur Unmilitam Jena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha Mukham Karoti Vachalam Bhangam Langaite Girim Yap Kripatam Ham Vande Shri Guru Dinatarane Paramananda Madhavam Paramananda He Madhava Pandungalu Chima Karanda Se Makaranda Panakari Anande Bhalo Hari Hari Harika Name Vanda Vela Harikari Ve Chaka Dola Se Chaka Dolanka Payare Manamo Rahu Nirantare Manamo Nirantare Rahu Ha Krishna Bali Jiva Jao Ha Krishna Bali Jao Jiva Mote Udara Radhadava Mote Udara Radhadava, Mote Udara Radhadava. Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Tapata Kamalam Shri Guru Vaishnavam Sha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunatham Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Sadhutam Purjana Saitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padan Sahagana Laita Shivskanitam Sha Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Pasaya Bhutale Shimate Gaur Govinda Swaminiti Namane Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Radhikeya Priyatmane Shishimad Bhakti Vedanta Narayaniti Namane
Otherwise, it will take too much time. I offer my Dhanva Pranams to the lotus feet of my Diksha Guru. I offer my Dhanva Pranams to the lotus feet of my Diksha Guru, Om Vishnu Pad, Paramahamsa, Astolas, Shishimai Shila Gaur-Govinda Goswami Maharaj, and my beloved Siksha Guru, Om Vishnu Pad, Paramahamsa, Astolas, Shishimai Shila Bhakti Vinata Narayan Goswami Maharaj, and to my Param Gurudev, Nichol Krishna Pad Paramahamsa, Astotas Shishimachila Isi Bhakti Vedanta Swami Prabhupada, And it's really Krishna Pad Paramahamsa Stotras Chishimachala Bhakti began Kishigo Samaj. And our Paramaham Guru Nichola Krishna Pad Paramahamsa Stotras Chishimachala Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Goswami Prabhupada. I beg that I may be able to say something in glorification of my beloved Diksha Guru. Actually, in front of all the assembled devotees, I'm a little bit apprehensive to speak, although I do speak quite often, but not in front of such exalted devotees. So I'm begging the lotus feet of Gurudev and the lotus feet of all the Vaishnavas here, they may be merciful to me, allow me to say something of value. Brahmanda Brahmante Khan Bhagavan Jiva Guru Krishna Pashari Bhai Bhagavata Devi. Okay. I'm going to explain something. Okay. Actually, in position of speaking of my Guru Maharaj, it's a little bit difficult for me in front of all the Vaishnavas, but I'm going to try anyway because it's my duty. The living entity is undergoing many, many lakhs of species of life, going through many, many Brahmandas, many, many lifetimes, many species, until you become very fortunate, Bhagavan Jiva, to come across such a Gurudev who gives him his Bhakti Lata Beej. Actually, I'm not able to speak right now, and I'm just going to, whatever I say, I'll say. You have to be merciful to me. I'll have to find some people that I'm used to speaking to. I will. I'm going to actually explain something about the Srila Gaugamila Maharaj was very, very merciful to the conditioned souls, especially in ISKCON, and that he had the order to stay in the society, and he was much, much restricted in his preaching. Yet, he, as Gurudev was explaining earlier, he was so much bold in his preaching that he would not allow anyone to stop him in his preaching. Regardless, he was gradually getting more and more bolder as he saw the scope for preaching in the West. And I remember one thing he had come across. It's explained Krishna Surya Sama Maya Haya Andhikara. All right, sorry. That Krishna is like the sun. Krishna is like the sun, and Maya is like darkness. And
wherever there is Krishna,
Tamadu Dayasada Govinda Vishnam. That Krishna is in the heart of the pure devotee. So whenever I was with Srila Govinda Maharaj, I had so much association. It was always like Krishna was there. I could always feel so much high presence. Just one example: I was driving in a car with him about 2 hours, an hour and a half late for a program. And it was a big crowd of traffic, and we were going on a bridge, and we were going to be about 2.5 hours of our program. I was totally in anxiety, and Srila Gaugamila was sitting there, just chanting Nam. He wasn't at all concerned about the externals. And then when I turned to him, I said, Gurudev, is this Maya? And he turned to me and said, Maya has no scope for these affairs. He's very, very powerful. So he was actually very much setting the situation for me, my heart, what his position was in such a way. Mike, okay. I'd rather just sit down and it'd be much easier for me to speak.
Don't laugh.
So I'm going to just reiterate what I really want to do, Gurudev, in front of you. I wanted to speak about how Srila Gaugamila Maharaj gave me instructions when I traveled with him in 1991, 92, 93, and 94 extensively in the West, in America. He had actually, in 1991, he stressed the importance of being under this association, constant association of a Mahabhagavat, Sadhu Guru. He'd always say, Sadhu is always there, Charya is always there, the pure devotees are always there, Vaishnava is always there. He said he would always stress it so much that one time I came to the conclusion that perhaps he's telling me this conclusion more than anyone else in this world, because he stressed it every day, every day, every day. So it was like it was ingrained in my heart. So Srila Gaugamila Maharaj always spoke how Sadhu's words are not theoretical, they're very, very practical. So his words came 100% true, because he said, He explained how the Guru is not limited to the body, and the Guru will constantly give us guidance. So he said, if we pray, the lotus feet of our Gurudev, always, constant, will always be under that guidance. So what happened during his divine departure, I actually had a very amazing experience before. It was in regards to my Govardhan Srila. I had this Govardhan that I was going to get in Vrindavan, and Srila Govardhan had overnight changed the Siddhanta about worshipping Govardhan as from Krishna to Haridasa Varya. And I was totally bewildered. Why is this? And I asked him, and he didn't give me a very good answer. He gave me an answer because the Bhagavatam says so. It wasn't a substantial answer. And it left me with doubt, thinking, why? And anyway, I left Bhuvaneshwar with this doubt in my mind. Who is Govardhan? Is he Vishnu Tattva? Is he Jiva Tattva? Shakti Tattva? I could not understand. So then I got this Govardhan in Vrindavan. I went back to the West and I worshipped him for several months. Srila Govardhan went on tour with us, and we traveled with him in Europe. And then when he returned, again, this desire, who is Govardhan? So one day I prayed to my heart, I'm praying, who is Govardhan? I prayed to my being, Govardhan Srila, who are you? Who are you? Are you Vishnu Tattva, Jiva Tattva, Maya Tattva? Not Maya Tattva. Jiva Tattva, Vishnu Tattva, Shakti Tattva, who are you? And then Srila Govardhan, that evening, when I woke up in the morning, actually, Ashram Maharaj came up to me with a book from Srila Bhakti Vandana Narayan Maharaj, and we were in ISKCON, and he said, "Hey, Maranabhata, I got some amazing thing to show you." And I said, "What is that?" He said, "Bam!" And he called me into his room, it was like confidential. He said, "This book is by Srila Narayan Maharaj." He said, "It's called Venugit." And in this Venugit, there's a chapter about Govardhan. I think you'll find it very interesting. So actually, I read this chapter and answered all of my questions exactly how I've been praying. And then at that moment, my faith in Srila Bhakti Vandana Narayan Maharaj was increasing so much stronger in my heart. And then a few weeks later, it was Govardhan Puja, and Ashram Maharaj asked me to give class, so I took notes. And as I spoke this topic, Gurudev had spoken of, in my own words, it had so much signification. My realization about the whole situation of Govardhan and Gurudev's position was increasing. And then sometime later, I had some dream, and Gurudev came to me in a very mysterious dream before I had really established a relationship with him. And at the conclusion of this dream, I won't go into details, is that I woke up with some solidified Shraddha in Gurudev, and increased my Shraddha for my own Diksha Guru, Srila Govardhan Maharaj. And all of our acharyas. And then Srila Govardhan and I had a conversation on the telephone, and he was telling me how now you're following my instructions, so you're getting creeper. And then he hung up, and I then called him back, and I said, "Gurudev, we got hung up," and although I knew he hung up on me, we got hung up, and I said, "Gurudev, but I feel like I've been getting bunched, and I'm not really qualified. I've been not following your instructions nicely." He said, "Now you're following, you're getting creeper, and he hung up the phone. And 1 hour later, I received a fax. It was an unsolicited fact, and he said, "Dear Raghunath Bhatta, accept my blessings. This is my schedule during the Mayapur festival," and he gave me dates, and then he said, "For Sadhu Sangha, come at this time." And it had no meaning. What kind of letter is this? I never received such a letter with dates. What kind of letter is this? And then I couldn't understand the true purport of this till later. So what happened is, Srila Govardhan gave me instruction during that conversation to stay in Birmingham till Govinda Bhakata, Ashram Maharaj, comes back. We were watching the Birmingham temple. So when he came back, then I was to go to India. And I was trying to go to Calcutta. Anyway, I'll make it real quick. I went to Delhi, and the day I arrived in Delhi, that very day, next day I went to Vrindavan, and that same day Gurudev had arrived in Mathura. So when I arrived in Mathura, one devotee told me, "Hey, did you hear what's happening in Mathura?" I said, "What happened?" She said, "Narayana, it's just arrived." So I went. And I kept a low profile, and I stayed in the back. There was maybe about 500 devotees in Mathura temple, Keshaji Gaudi Math. And Gurudev was speaking in Hindi. It was the middle of his lecture, and I was thinking, how can I speak with him? Because there's so many people here, he's speaking in Hindi. It's impossible. And I was praying that I could have some darshan with Gurudev. Because actually, Srila Govardhan was leaving, and it was such an amazing transformation. It wasn't a period for myself in which there was a space of bewilderment, actually. It was just a transformation from one form of worshiping my Gurudev to another form. Because he gave me some special mercy in this way, although myself, I feel totally unqualified.
to receive this mercy, but somehow he gave it. And then Gurudev got from his Vyasa sign, got up, and he walked right towards me. And there was nobody between me and Gurudev. And I immediately put my head on his lotus feet, and Gurudev said, he went like this, he put his hand up like this. And I was thinking, oh, he means, can't you see there's so many people later, I'll speak with them. I was not so accustomed to Gurudev's gesture of giving kripa like this. And then Gurudev sat in his chair right where his old room used to be downstairs, and I sat right in front of him, and there were so many hundreds of people there, and I was right on my knees next to Gurudev, and Gurudev looked at me, and he asked me, what's your name? What is your name? And I said, my name is Raghunath Bhatta, I'm a disciple of Srila Gaura Govinda Maharaj. Before my Guru Maharaj left his body, I had a dream that I was left at your lotus feet begging for prayer. And when I said that, Gurudev said, yes, I will help you. And at that moment, it was very, very mystical. And I stayed in, and Gurudev was testing me, telling me to go to Rupa Sanatan and I could stay there. I wanted to be with Gurudev, I wanted to get some association. I wanted my questions and my doubts to be answered. Am I doing the right thing? But it was so much of a heavy test in that place, actually, in Keshavaji Gaudiya, a very, very tricky place, actually. Very mystical place, and that was my perception. And then, finally, I was able to speak to Gurudev a little bit more, but so many things had happened. And then when I went to Bhubaneswar, I was having some type of dreams every night that time in Keshavaji Gaudiya. Then I went to Bhubaneswar, and I went to Srila Gaura Maharaj's his Bhajayatir and his Samadhi, and I was begging for mercy, and I was asking, am I doing the right thing or am I doing the wrong thing? You please help me. Actually, before that, Gurudev was going to an evening program, and I'm saying this because it's related to the mercy of Srila Gaura Maharaj is not coming in any other way but coming in the form of the Siksha Guru. That's why I'm relating the story. And I wanted to say this in front of Gurudev, but I don't know how I'm speaking nicely or not nicely. Anyway. So Gurudev was at an evening program and he was speaking in Hindi. And then he turned to me and said, so, if the whole world is against you and you have Krishna sanction, what is the loss? And if the whole world is on your side and you don't have Krishna sanction, what can the whole world give you? And Gurudev said that and it was like bullets in my heart. It hit me so hard because he knew that I was going to go through so much external difficulty, with so much opposition, people trying to put me down, making me think I'm doing the wrong thing. So I had this doubt, am I doing the right thing or the wrong thing? This is my doubt. Am I doing the right thing? Am I doing what I'm supposed to do? So then when I went to Bhubaneswar, Srila Gaura Maharaj's Samadhi was there, and I prayed to Srila Gaura Maharaj, my Guru Maharaj, for 20 minutes to a half hour, begging, please, you give me one sign, I'm doing the right thing or the wrong thing, please help me. I want to serve you, I want to do the right thing. And as soon as I got up, I went over to a bookcase, and I picked, spontaneously picked three or four books from the bookcase, and they were in different parts, and they were all Gurudev's books. One was Venu Geet, one was Bhakti Rasayana, or Sikshastika. And it was just like, I wasn't planning to, it was all books of Gurudev, and that was like confirmation. This is Srila Gaura Maharaj's bookshelves in Bhubaneswar. I picked three books spontaneously, they were all Gurudev's books. So I was thinking, is this not a sign? Then I went back to Mathura, and Gurudev was taking a massage, and he was sitting there, actually, and he was speaking, and then Gurudev said to me, you should understand that your Gurudev has not left. And at that very moment, I had so much inspiration that actually, yes, he's here in this form. So in this regard, Srila Gaura Maharaj, I'll just say one thing, that he was actually such a bold creature, in the sense that He was really fearless. He was not preaching in the Gaudiya Vedanta Samiti where his words were accepted by everyone. On the contrary, he would preach in such a way that certain envious people would leave the room, leave the temple. And as soon as they would leave, he would come out with so much heavy things. Very, very heavy. He was really heavy, really direct. And he was so heavy that sometimes I would be shaking, actually thinking it's too heavy. They're going to get blown out. So he would actually be so heavy. But actually I was thinking, externals, it looks like he was alone. He was alone, but he wasn't actually alone. Because he always said, I've heard him several times, he would say, I'm not speaking, I'm merely the reservoir coming from, I'm merely the pipe coming from the reservoir. And he would point to Prabhupada's prompting, he's prompting, I'm merely the pipe coming from the reservoir. He always said, Prabhupada's prompting, Mahaprabhu's prompting. So then he gave so many realizations how he was actually non-different from his Gurudev. We had that realization. So anyway, I have lots of things to say, but in this atmosphere, it's a little hard for me actually to express myself. I had plans to say something, but it doesn't come out the way I want.
You should know a trick how we in brief everything should be. This is the truth. And this is quality. That in brief, we should speak that all essence should come in there. If you are speaking for hours, hours, but not anything important, then how we can learn? Only 1 minute.
Okay, I just beg the Lord's feet that I may become a qualified disciple and serve my Guru eternally, and I serve you eternally as well.
Thank you. But more than 10 or 15 minutes.
Om Gyan Dhurasya Vandanaya Salakaya Chakshuran Militam Yena Tasmai Sri Guruvai Namaha Vanchakalpatarubhascha Kripasindubhyavacha Patitanam Bhavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha. So first of all, I offer my Dandavat Pranam to the feet of my Guru Pada Padma Om Vishnu Pad Sri Bhaktivinoda Narayana Goswami Maharaj, then the Lord's feet of my Vatnapadakshi Guru and Shiksha Guru Pada Padma, which is the priest Srila Gaugavinda Goswami Maharaj. So the life of Srila Gaugavinda Maharaj, completely extraordinary. Bandana Kurite Shakti, Jani Jani Jani. We have no power to glorify Vaishnava, but still we have some little greed to glorify their qualities, their teachings, their pastimes. So Grihajana Shikshaka, Nyasi Kula Nayaka. Just like Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was perfect Grihasta and perfect sannyasi, in the life of Srila Gaugavinda Maharaj we can see exactly the same thing. Even as a small boy, he said the first book that I learned to read was Srimad Bhagavatam and Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita. So by the time he was 11 years old, he said he had already read the Bhagavatam 5 times and the Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita 5 times. So he had no desire to enter into the Grihastha ashram, except he said his mother was putting pressure on. He said, the first time I met my wife was at the wedding. So he said, I was with my wife 7 times in my life, so I have 7 children. So in this way you can see, even as a Grihastha who is completely sense controlled, so in this way there's no difference between bona fide sannyasi and bona fide Grihastha who follows. So he was from a very poor family, so he had no chance to go to university. So even as a child, he was teaching at the school, and nighttime he would study. So when he went for his exam, he became second in the whole state of Orissa, despite studying at nighttime. So he was very fond of Harikatha, even as a teacher. In fact, he always used to teach, especially Srimad Bhagavad Gita, to his students. So one day, the inspector came and he heard that Srila Gaugavinda Maharaj was speaking so much Harikatha. So the inspector became very angry. Oh, you should not teach Bhagavad Gita, you should teach mathematics, Odia, English, philosophy, science. So Srila Gaugavinda Maharaj was not saying anything, and next day again he began to teach again from Srimad Bhagavad Gita. So that time the inspector came and said, what are you teaching? And Srila Gaugavinda Maharaj was silent, and the inspector opened up Srila Gaugavinda Maharaj's textbooks and inside was Bhagavad Gita, inside. So the inspector became very angry and Srila Gaugavinda Maharaj became disgusted. Oh, that place, I cannot speak Harikatha, no need to stay there. So quickly after that, he renounced everything and took vanaprastha, like vanaprastha. So many of his students actually became his disciples when he started to preach. Many, 10 or 15 of his students became his disciples after. So when Srila Gaugavinda Maharaj left home, the village became very angry and they tried to tie him up. They tried to tell, oh, you have become quite mad. How you can leave 7 children? How you can leave a wife? That time his oldest son was only 18 years old. But Srila Gaugavinda Maharaj, when he was tied up, he said, you can tie my body, but you cannot tie my soul. And that time his wife said, no, no, I had a dream last night. Krishna has already given him sannyas, so you should let him go. So that night when Srila Gaugavinda Maharaj left, he walked and walked and walked and came to one village. So to cross to that village, you have to cross the Mahanadi River. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu used to take bath there also. So that river was very, very deep. So he was thinking, how will I cross? There is no boat. Then he saw one man walking across the river. And he thought, oh, that must be where it is very shallow. So he also went there and crossed across the river. When he came to the villagers asked, oh, Baba, where did you come? Oh, I came from across. How did you cross the river? Oh, I walked. This is very shallow. And all the villagers said, are you mad? That river is 50 feet deep. So Srila Gaurava said, oh, I think that was Krishna showing me. Oh, you crossed here. So late at night, one very old lady in white cloth, she came and she did dandavats to Srila Gaurava Maharaj. So Srila Gaurava Maharaj asked, oh, Mata, why are you giving dandavats to me? Who are you? She said, I am giving dandavats to you because you have done what no one else has done. You have left me. You have left me. Srila Gaurava Maharaj said, who was that old lady? She was Maya Devi. You have left me. So we know, we heard a little bit this morning, Srila Gaurava Maharaj wandered for 2 years all over India, especially Himalayas, Haridwar. He said, I was trying to find a guru who could teach me the precepts of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. He said, but I could not find anyone to inspire me. Finally, he decided to come to Vrindavan. He thought, Krishna must fulfill my desire in Vrindavan for a bona fide guru. So there he saw the white Hare Krishnas chanting Hare Bol. He became astonished. So one of them gave him a back to Godhead. So he thought, I'm looking this back to Godhead for three things. I'm looking for Maha Mantra. I'm looking for Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And I'm looking for Srimad Bhagavatam. So when he opened this back to Godhead, he saw Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Maha Mantra and Srimad Bhagavatam. He said, I want to meet that Srila Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj. So when he went there, it was very hard for him to meet actually, because they thought he was like Mayavadi. He had dreadlocks, wasn't it, very bright saffron cloth, but Tilak, Vaishnava Tilak. So first they would give no chance to meet. So finally he persevered, he went inside. Immediately Srila Prabhupada, Srila Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj asked, oh, have you taken sannyas? No, Maharaj. Oh, I will give you sannyas. So Srila Gaurava Maharaj said, because he spoke it was in the core of my heart, that I knew he must be my spiritual master, and I surrendered everything to him. So Srila Gaurava Maharaj, also when he was a grihastha, every morning very early he would wake up at 3 o'clock in the morning and chant Harinam and perform the Tulsi Pirikram. One night, one sadhu came to his house. So Srila Gaurava Maharaj had 7 children, his wife and him, all slept underneath one blanket. So when the sadhu was leaving, Srila Gaurava Maharaj folded that blanket and gave to the sadhu. So his wife became very angry. Oh, we are 7 children and we only have one blanket. And you have given that blanket to the sadhu. So Srila Gaurava said, yes, we have a house, but the sadhu has no house. So you can imagine how perfect he was, sannyasi. So Prabhupada sent him to Bhuvaneshwar to preach. That time he was completely alone. He had no money, nothing. So Prabhupada said to him, I want you to build a temple as big as Jagannath Puri. So Srila Gaurava Maharaj was, oh, how I can, I'd have no even 2 rupees to rub together. How will I build a temple as big as Jagannath Puri? But he said, no, the sadhu is such a sankalpa. Anything he says must come true. So first Srila Gaurava Maharaj said, when I was living on that land, the only construction was the ant hills, the termite hills. Nothing else was there. And my only companion were the ghosts and snakes and scorpions. A really dangerous place. So because he had nowhere to live for the first 3 months of staying there, he had to live in the construction hut of the road workers. And every day he would do his, Prabhupada gave him many orders, build a temple as big as Jagannath Puri, preach all around the world and translate all my books into Odia. So Srila Gaurava Maharaj gave the example of a completely perfect disciple. Srila Gaurava Maharaj, one of his main teachings, how do we get the mercy of Guru Pada Padma? You have to follow the order of Guru as it is, without twisting, without changing anything. And he used to give a very nice example of Parasuram. Parasuram, incarnation of Godhead. So one time, his father, he was very angry, Jamanagni was very angry with his wife. And he ordered his eldest son, chop off the head of your mother. But the oldest son, how I can chop off the head of my mother? This is great sinful, I cannot do. The second son would also not do. But when he was ordered, Parasuram took off his axe, chopped off the head of his mother and his 2 brothers for disobeying the order of the spiritual master. So Srila Gaurava Maharaj said, giving example, Guru says do this, just do it without changing, without twisting anything, then you can attain the mercy of Guru Pada Padma. So, very difficult place to preach in Orissa. We see in the Western countries, people do not know so much Siddhanta, don't know so much philosophy, so therefore preaching is a little bit easier. But in Orissa, very hard to preach. There is many, many against the Sampradaya of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Especially, you know, all upper Sampradayas are there. Bhajai Nitai Gaur, Adesham, Hare Krishna, all are there, all against. So Srila Gauri Maharaj was preaching right in the middle of the nest of those who are against the teachings of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So very boldly, he established the deities of three deities of Balaram. Gaur Nitai, Sri Krishna Balaram, Jagannath Baladev Subhadra. When Srila Nityalila Srila Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj, he said, this is my last founded project. And Prabhupada put his cane in the ground. I leave all my mercy here. I leave all my mercy here. So after very many years of great struggle, he built that temple and he was going to install the Vigraha. So Srila Bhaktivedanta Swami had given him very detailed instructions. The deity should be made of brass, it should be shaped like this. So when the time came for the deity installation, all God brothers, all GBC, no Maharaj, you cannot install brass deities. This is not practical. We should bring the marble deities from Jaipur. And Srila Gauri Maharaj was saying, no, this is the order of my guru, but they were completely against. No, you have to follow us. So Srila Gauri Maharaj stood up and he went to leave the temple. They asked, oh Maharaj, where are you going? He said, if I cannot follow the order of my guru, I'm going next door and I'm building another temple. And after I build the same temple, I will install the deities that my spiritual master meant. Oh, okay, Maharaj, you can do it. So very nice deities there, especially one nice story I want to tell you. You can understand how much Srila Gauri Maharaj had prem for the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Bhagavan became completely controlled by him. So we think it's very easy to control Bhagavan. Bhagavan is not, like Guru Maharaj says, no 2 rupee rasgulla. So to control him is no joke. And that Vaishnava who is controlled him, can you imagine his potency, his purity? So Sripad Lokanath Maharaj from the ISKCON Padyatra, he had deities of Gaur Nitai. So they were coming on, they came to Orissa, and one of the bulls, Ramnam Satyadev, finished. So the bulls were from Gujarat, those bulls are very big, and in Orissa, the bulls are very small. So Lokanath Maharaj, Sripad Lokanath Maharaj asked to Srila Gauri Maharaj, oh Maharaj, you take care of Gaur Nitai, I'm going to Gujarat, and I'll bring some more deities here. So Srila Gauri Maharaj, okay, he knew how to cook. He said, before I took Vanaprastha, I made sure I knew how to cook chapatis and dal. He said, every day with my own hands, I would cook for the Lord and offer with my own hands. After 1 month, Sripad Lokanath Maharaj came back. Oh Maharaj, yes, give me Gaur Nitai. Now I will return. So Srila Gauri Maharaj went before the deities. Oh dear, Sri Gaur Nitai, now I'm afraid you have to go. Lokanath Maharaj is here. But Gaur Nitai said, no, I don't want to go. We like it here with you. We like your Dharma. I want to stay here. So Srila Gauri Maharaj was very shocked. He went to Lokanath Maharaj. I'm sorry, Maharaj. The deities do not want to go. So Sripad Lokanath Maharaj became very angry. Maybe he thought Srila Gauri Maharaj is joking or something. No, no, they have to go. They are Padyatra deities. So Srila Gauri Maharaj went back again. Oh, I'm sorry, Gaur Nitai. Lokanath Maharaj is insisting. You have to go on Padyatra. And Srila Gauri Maharaj, this time Gaur Nitai was angry. No, no, we don't want to go. We don't want to go. We want to stay with you. So Srila Gauri Maharaj went back to I'm sorry, Lokanath Maharaj. Not possible. So Srila Gauri Maharaj, very, one of his wonderful specialities, how much he preached Prayojan Tattva. He said, your goal is Krishna Prem. Every lecture, Premayacha Bonde, Vidyavita, Jahanetirtaha, Dekiyayama. The pure Vaishnava, everywhere he looks, because he has the eyes of love, Primanjana, Churataya, Bhakti, Valachanena, Sandasa, Desu, Vidyas, Varoki, Antim, Yachama, Sundaram, Achintya, Guna, Surupam, Govinda Mari, Purusham, Tamaham, Bhajami. The pure Vaishnava he has, Primanjana, the ointment of pure love. He said, what is Gaudiya Math? What is ISKCON? This is the factory of Guru Pada Padma. And what are they making this factory? They're making the ointment of pure love. So we are here serving in the factory of Guru Maharaj. And we are asking for the wage. What is the wage? That ointment of pure love of Godhead. So always, every lecture he was stressing, our goal is Krishna Prem. Your goal is Krishna Prem. How you get it? Krishna Bhakti Jamamaya Hoi Sarvasam Krishna Prema Jamatena Puna Mukhya. The only place you get pure Sarvasanga is in the association of pure Vaishnava. He used to say, how much Krishna you want? Do you want 5%? Do you want 10%? Do you want 20%? If you want 100% Krishna, then you have to go to the 100% sadhu and completely surrender there. Without duplicity, without Without crookedness, completely surrender that to the sadhu, you will definitely get Krishna Prem. So we know Srila Gauga Maharaj tried very hard to fulfill all the desires of his Guru Maharaj. So how do we know the glories of Nityananda Prasad Srila Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj? How do we know he was great? How do we know he was a Premi Bhakta? How do we know he was empowered by his Guru? Because he could make one disciple like Nityananda Prasad Srila Gauga Maharaj. Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur, he had 60,000 disciples. He said, if I can make one pure disciple, then my Guruship is successful. So we know the glories of Srila Prabhupada. He could make such an empowered personality like Srila Gauga Maharaj. So I'm very lucky that I could meet him. He completely pulled me out of a very terrible situation, completely engrossed in Maya. So he was very, very affectionate to all his disciples. Also, so today we are feeling great loss, great separation. But also we are also especially indebted to him, because only by his mercy, by his teachings, he could put that greed in the heart of all disciples. His disciples became like madmen to hear Harikatha. They became like madmen for Sadhu Sangha. So that is his mercy. He could make wretched persons, fallen persons, he could make them mad for Guru and Gauranga. So his disappearance today, we are begging his mercy. So I'd like to thank him very much, because he personally indicated one time I asked him in Calcutta Airport, oh, Guru Maharaj, he was in Calcutta, so I asked him, I have a great fear. What will I do when you leave your body, when you leave this world? How will I do service? Under whose guidance will I do service? I don't understand. So he laughed and said, oh, you should immediately run to the Shiksha Guru. So then I asked him, but who do I go to? I don't know anyone. So Srila Gauga Maharaj said, don't worry, I will arrange everything. Gurudev will arrange all association. So I'm very lucky he put me under the guidance of Guru Maharaj. One small thing also. One time he came to Singapore. So that time we had the good fortune to meet Pujapad Padmanabh Maharaj and Pran Kishore Prabhu. They were collecting with paintings, and we were also collecting with paintings. Srila Gauga Maharaj said, beg, borrow, steal, just bring money. I have to finish this temple. Prabhupada is beating me every day. Oh, Gauri Govinda, oh, God, why you have not finished the temple? So we met these two nice devotees, and we were always talking about Srila Gauga Maharaj, and I were always talking about Srila Guru Maharaj. So I became astonished. Oh, only we can talk about our Guru Maharaj. No one else can talk about their Guru Maharaj. So they had so much faith in him, so I became curious. So when we came to Calcutta, we took that chance, and I asked, oh, Srila Maharaj, Srila Guru Maharaj, everyone is leaving ISKCON and going to Srila Narayan Maharaj. What is your opinion of that? What do you think of that? So Srila Gauga Maharaj became very grave. He said, you should understand what is ISKCON, who is a bona fide member of ISKCON. ISKCON means International Society for Krishna Consciousness. So that Vaishnava who is 100% Krishna conscious, he's an actual life member of ISKCON. He said, you are thinking ISKCON, non-ISKCON, but this has nothing to do with Vaishnavism. So this was like an atom bomb in my head, because Srila Gauga Maharaj was completely dedicated to ISKCON and completely dedicated to the service of his spiritual master. So coming from him, I never heard anything like it. So I was very stunned. Then he stood up and he said in a soft voice, he said, yes, and if you get the chance for his association, you should run there. So when I looked around, I couldn't believe no one else heard it. That was Jason. He said it, Jason, I don't know, Ryoga Mara Mahamaya, only I heard it. So Srila Gauga Maharaj, the last thing he said to me, I remember, he was going to Mayapur. So I asked him, can I come with you to Mayapur? He said, no need to go there. You just stay here. So the last class he gave was the most astonishing class. Maybe 150 verses. He was such a vastly learned personality, you cannot imagine. Maybe 150, 200 verses in that class, all about the 10 divisions of Srimad Bhagavatam, the Puranas. And he said, unless you know all these things, you cannot become a Vaishnava. So I was thinking, oh my God. So every day I tried to ask one question. So that, I said, Srila Guru Maharaj, you are saying that unless we know all this Siddhanta, that we can't become a Vaishnava. but I don't know Sanskrit, don't know Bengali, even my English is not very strong. Does that mean I cannot become a Vaishnava? So last thing he said, Are Mukum Karoti Vacharam Pam Gun Langate Girim Yatkipa Tamaham Bande Shri Gulinatana. He said, one day you'll sit on Vyasa-san and all the Vedas will come out of your mouth. He says, that time you will not be speaking. It will be coming automatically. He said, then you will realize the mercy of your Guru Maharaj. So, thank you very much.
Though ISKCON leaders, they never want that I should visit their any center. They were and are very against. But I think Guru Gobind Maharaj wanted that my Shri Vikram should be established by Narayan Maharaj. And that is why he inspired his disciples. Then
Jagadish
Pandit and Sachinandan especially. Sachinandan, very powerful. And he was working in government anywhere, very powerful. So he called me. All were against this, but he was powerful. He never heard him. And he called, I went there. And I established with all my hands two vigraha. One in the temple and one in the side. In the morning I told so many things about him. But I don't believe in dreams so much. If a snake is coming and biting you, then in woke up, when he woke up, will that snake will come and bite? So don't give importance of dreams. Only the importance of dreams are for those who are a realized person. They're walking and sleeping. So same thing. But our not. So try to tell, glorify. Like Laukik Sadh Bandhuva. There should be no question. I know Guru Gobind Maharaj was manifestation of Abhiram Goswami. You know Abhiram Goswami? When he used to sprinkle his mercy to anyone, he has a whip. And he used to come. This was his mercy. And Krishna Prema used to come. I think he used also used. He had a danda stick. And I think very rare disciple will be that those who have not taken his danda on his back or head are here and there. This was a special mercy. But I think no one was unhappy. All having his lathi stayed here, inspired so much. That I know, I have heard. Jagadish Pandit and so many there. Have you received a stick on your back or anywhere?
Many times.
Many times. You have not.
Jagadish Pandit in one class 20 times.
Anyhow, we are offering Pushpanjali in his lotus feet today. He should be pleased to sprinkle his mercy on us that we should be like. Now, Shyam Rani Sutta speaks something in brief, direct, not indirect. Like you told about or Guru Maharaj something indirect. Or you should tell direct about his life and his about Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati.
Om Jnanam Timirandasya Jnanam Janasalakaya Chaksurun Militam Yena Tasmai Sri Gurave Namah. First, I offer my unlimited obeisances in the dust of the lotus feet of my Paramarajatama, Diksha Guru Padapadma, Nichalila Pravishta Om Vishnu Pad, Astotara Satashri Shrimad Srila Bhakti Vedanta Swami Prabhupada. And the same unlimited obeisances in the dust of the lotus feet of my Paramarajatama Shiksha Guru Padapadma, Om Vishnu Pad Astotara Satashri Srimad Srila Bhakti Vedanta Narayan Goswami Maharaj, and to my Param Gurudev, Nichalila Pravishta Om Vishnu Pad Astotara Satashri Srimad Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Goswami Prabhupada. Last year in Germany, Srila Gurudev spoke something about Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur. One of his glories is that he re-established the sannyas ashram and re-established the sacred thread. He was criticized that this has not been done before. But actually he established that this was done since the beginning of time. This was in the pastimes of Ramchandra with Viswamitra Muni. This was in the pastimes of Janaka Maharaj asking Jagyavalka, how can we perfect our lives? And he responded by telling how one goes through brahmachari, grihastha, varnaprastha, and sannyas. So Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur, as Gurudev explained this morning, he wanted to purify the whole system so that one can actually become perfect in Krishna consciousness by re-establishing the rules and regulations that had been lost in the what was called the Gaudiya Sampradaya. Before him, people who were respectable would abhor the name of Gaudiya Sampradaya. But he and his father and Gurudev, Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, re-established the integrity of the Gaudiya Sampradaya by establishing the sannyas system. During the time of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Mahaprabhu took sannyas, as did Nityananda Prabhu and Sarup Damodar and others. But under him, the six Goswamis and Lokanath Goswami, Bhugarbha Goswami, they felt that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So we shouldn't imitate him and take sannyas. Also, the Rupa and Sanatan were thinking, we're Muslims, we shouldn't take sannyas. We should just take simple Babaji Vesh, just wear a white cloth. There was no scriptural name Babaji, just we should take white cloth and not imitate. But gradually this became degraded, and as Gurudev said this morning, all the Babajis began to have so many widows and engage in so-called parakiya ras with these widows. So in order to establish the integrity of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's sampradaya, he re-established the sannyas system. That is, our previous Goswamis, they are Paramahamsas. They're beyond rules and regulations. So they should wear Paramahamsa Vesh. But now we are conditioned souls, so putting the Paramahamsa Vesh on our heads, we should again follow Varnashram and with the system of brahmachari to sannyas. Also, He re-established the sacred thread ceremony that not only those who were born in a Brahmin family would be called Brahmin, but actually one who's qualified to be Brahmana, who's taken initiation by a bona fide guru and who's following the instructions and principles of Brahminical life, no matter what station he's from, no matter what country he's from, he can become a bona fide Brahmana, just as bell metal mixed with mercury can become gold. So anyone in any country can accept Brahminical initiation from a bona fide Sadguru and become a bona fide Brahmana and gradually a pure devotee of the Lord. He was a great, perfect follower of Bhaktivinoda Dwara, the line of Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur. And he understood his Gurudev and father better than anyone. I hope this isn't indirect. But there was an Ishtagosti held in 1952 in Chaitanya Saraswat Math, wherein many sannyasi disciples of Srila Prabhupada were present. And one of the participants in the Ishtagosti very humbly asked that there seems to be a difference in opinion between the commentary of Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur and the commentary of Srila Prabhupada Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur in the fifth verse of Sri Upadeshamrit, Krishneti Yashagiri Tam Manasadriyeta Dikshasti Che Pranati Vishchavadant Nisham. So then one of the sannyasis asked, what is the difference? And he said, there appears to be a difference because Srila Bhakti Vinod Thakur said that one should offer pranam from the core of his heart to anyone who's chanting nam, even if there's no sambandha, even if that person is ignorant, he doesn't have much knowledge of tattva, and even if, as long as he's initiated by a sadguru, and as long as he's doesn't engage in immoral behavior, in illicit connection with women or mayavadis. But Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, his commentary is different, or appears to be different. He says that one should offer pranam within the core of one's heart and with his physical obeisances. If one is chanting nam with sambandha, that he has some realization of his relationship with Krishna, that he's accepted diksha from a sadguru, and he's continually chanting nam with love and affection, and he realizes that nam and nami are one, and he realizes that the sadhana of nam is the only process or method of attainment. So this devotee asked, how can we reconcile this apparent difference, or whom should we follow? So because this was at the Chaitanya Saraswat Math, Pujapada Srila Sridhar Maharaj replied that mostly our acharyas have the same opinion, but here we see that there's a slightly different opinion. But we should accept the commentary of Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, because he is the guru of Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur. And he said his commentary is verified by Shastra. And he quoted so many verses from Shastra. Sakarapi, Sakramakadapi, Shradhaya, Heliava. Even if one doesn't have any faith, if he chants the holy name of Krishna, that nam will deliver Uttama Adhikari. So similarly, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur is going deeper into the meaning of Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur by saying that it's true that as soon as nam touches the tongue, namatmakam, as soon as nam touches the tongue, rasa sprig, then the taste of nam touching the tongue gives automatic liberation, and it automatically gives Krishna prema even. But what is the quality of the tongue that will get touched by the name. That is, if we're speaking about Nama Parad, that name does not deliver, and that name needs Diksha and all kinds of other purificatory activities in order to have effect. But the pure Nam, that name doesn't need any help. It doesn't need any previous regulative purification activities to chant. It doesn't require Diksha, it doesn't require anything. So when Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur is saying that one should honor a person who's actually received Diksha in a certain way, this Diksha means real Diksha, that he's actually has some transcendental knowledge of his relationship with Krishna, and Ksha, his anarthas have gone away. And Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur explained that one who's chanting real Nam means Param Vijayate Sri Krishna Sankirtan. Sarva Bhavito Kirtan. Sarvena Bhavito Kirtan. One who's chanting in Bhava Bhakti, and one who's such a person begins to chant Shuddha Nam. He's really chanting Nam. And such a person, actually, we offer respects within the deepest core of our heart, and with our obeisances, and with service. So, Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur gives the deeper meaning of Srila Bhakti Vinod Thakur. And from him, we learn how to serve Srila Bhakti Vinod Thakur and the previous acharyas. Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur's pranam mantra says, Madhur Jojila Pramaja Sri Rupanuga Bhakti Da. That is, for someone to chant general Nam, then anyone can be offered respects for chanting Nama Parad. But if one wants to reach this Madhur Jojila Prem that Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came to give, then he gives himself and hears the Nam from one who's approaching pure devotee or one who is a pure devotee. So he came to give Sri Rupanuga Bhakti Da. He came to give that which Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came to give. Unat Ujjala Rasam So Bhakti Sriyam. That very rare opportunity of becoming a maidservant of Srimati Radhika. And he could not tolerate any statement that was against the teachings of Srila Rupa Goswami. Without proper understanding of Siddhanta from Rupa Goswami, by not making a distinction between Siddhanta and Upa Siddhanta, there's no way to advance in Krishna consciousness. Therefore, he destroyed, with all of his very strong arguments, anything that was against the statements of Srila Rupa Goswami. Srila Rupa Goswami is Srila Sri Rupa Manjari, and by following his Siddhanta, one gets his mood. Generally, we're very concerned about our own name and fame and who likes me and who doesn't like me and who honors me and who doesn't honor me. So if anyone is doubting, why should I be so concerned about these specifics that he was criticized for giving sannyas, or he was criticized for giving sacred thread, or he was criticized for taking sannyas from a picture of his Gurudev instead of his Gurudev in front of him? Why should I be concerned about this? Why should I be concerned about establishing his glory and defending his integrity? What does that have to do with my general life? They have everything to do with our general life. He is Nayana Manjari. That means in that realm, he is like the twinkle of the eye in Srimati Radhika to help her to see Krishna. Whenever she's feeling separation from Krishna, he's always helping her to meet and see Krishna. Similarly, she has another glance, another eye on this world. And Sri Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur is Srimati Radhika's eye on this world, Nayana Manjari. As she looks on this world to give this world mercy and take away all the unhappiness from this world, Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur is her eye. So if one wants to come to that platform of defending the integrity and honor of Srimati Radhika and get that Unat Ojvala Rasam Swabhakti Sriyam, or that Madhur Dojala Prema Adya that Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur came to give, where one can be as a chokidar in the just outside the kunj of Srimati Radhika, and Krishna's coming late, having been with some other gopi, and that Manjari will say, oh, you cannot come into the kunj of my Swamini. She has her honor. No one can cheat her and come in her kunj. So in order to come to that high platform that he wants to give, Madhuja Ojvala Prema Adya Sri Rupa Nuga Bhakti Da, in order to come to that platform of defending Srimati Radhika when she is insulted by Krishna, then we have to begin with Guru. Srila Gurudev explained that unless we're feeling intense separation for Guru, we can never feel it for Radha and Krishna. Similarly, when we know Siddhanta and we engage our life in defending and protecting the integrity and glory of our Gurudev and Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur and our Guru Parampara, then gradually we can come to get what he wanted to give, that Sri Rupanuga Bhakti Da.
In morning I told that Srila Bhakti Vinod Thakur gave Kurma mantra to Srila Prabhupada. But if he was also high devotee, high class of devotee, always sinking in the ocean of love and affection for Radha and Krishna, why he was given Kurma mantra? And Bhaktivinoda Thakur told to worship. Why? Because Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur bought a land in Calcutta and he wanted a house there for his whole family. And he wanted to be given to his family, and he will come to Sarupa Gandhi for bhajan. At that time, when Bhakti was dealing, from the ground, a Kurmadev manifested. Salagram, but it was Kurma. Then Bhakti Vinod Thakur told, by his mercy he has appeared here. So we should not throw him then out here. But who will mercy? I have no time. Because I will have to go to my office here and there. So he told Srila Prabhupada Bhakti Siddhanta, Bimlanam, oh Bimlanam, you should mercy and take this mercy. So no harm.
How old was he then? I think he was 6 or 7 years old. Very small.
Yes, 7.
7 years old.
At even me. I have heard that he gave this mantra at the age of 5. Or like Prahlad Maharaj, very genius. So he gave. So don't have doubt that 5 he gave. Kurma mantra to me. Or by accident it was. Also, you should know that he gives sannyas to so many persons. So many very qualified boys. I named yesterday.
This morning.
And he once he told Parvat Maharaj, from Odisha he was, I don't remember his place there, but from anyhow in Odisha he was. And he told that he used to go to Haridwar and other places to preach. And he gave a party and he went to preach in Haridwar and all these places. But he thought that, oh, so many pilgrims are going to Badri Narayan and Kedar, so I should go. And very quickly I will return back. And so he went there, Badri Narayan, and then Kedarnath, and he returned back. Prabhupada Bhaktisiddhanta Tirumurti is fact. He called back him, no need of preaching. He took his sannyas vesh and saffron cloth at once and told that now your name is Badri Narayan Dasadhikari. Prihas name. I will not allow you to be in saffron cloth and sannyas. And then for so many years he was in white dress, not sannyas, and now he becomes so humble, so much obedient, that all began to tell to Prabhupada, please be merciful, and returned back. Then Prabhupada mercifully returned back again. So he was so. Once a letter came from the house mother from our Gurudev. No? A letter came that I am now about to die. Please send my Vinod, that at the time of death I may see him for last time. I want nothing. What he has done good. But I want to see. Then Prabhupada called him and told, oh, you should go at once to your mother. Go and see her and serve and then return. He ordered, and our Guru Maharaj, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Keshava Goswami, he returned back. And then he went in a corner of a very dark room and began to chant, whole night chanting. He did not went to his mother. So the Prabhupada also had some doubt that whether he has gone or not, but I am not seeing him. So, questions. Has he gone? Follow my order or no? Oh, go and search him. And if he is here, call him. And then anyone came and told that he is in sitting in the dark room all night, chanting and weeping. When he called, then my Gurudev went. Why you could not went to your mother to see him? He in lying bed, death bed. Why you could not? Prabhupada, he told very humbly, looking on earth, weeping, that after millions and millions of life, pieces of life, I meet now in this human life to you. I don't want to miss. If I will go to my mother at the time of death, what will be? She may tell that, oh, my dear boy, I don't believe in or by any other choice. I believe in you and I have so much affection for you. After me, you should try to save them and support and nourish. So you should be. And look after Jamindari.
Land holdings.
Land holdings. So I will have to obey her last
order.
And then anyhow I will be engaged in desha and I will be very far away from your Lord's feet. That is, I am thinking what to do, not to do. All night I was restless. Prabhupada told that, yes, you are right. I was taking your test, whether you are going or not. I am very nishthur,
cruel-hearted.
I brought so many jewels, qualified sons and husbands of their family. I don't want they should be again involved. A brahmachari, pakka brahmachari and sannyasi, they should not go to their family person, even his wife, sister, son or anyone. Otherwise he should give up sannyas. Better to give sannyas, renounce order, but not to be by any trick or any thing that, oh, I should go and help my son, my wife, my children, my sister. Sannyas means samyaknas. So for both, nyas means to cut all the worldly relations and thickly be connected with Guru Padma and Vaishnava. Anyhow, Narottam Thakur, or Bhaktivinoda Thakur has written this. Sanyasin karya yehi na hai, kutumba layya kare bharana poshan, or he should go to his related persons. Sanyasin should. So, in this, Srila Prabhupada Bhakti Siddhanta Sati, Jagadananda. Oh, Jagadananda Pandit. Oh, not any ordinary person. Jagadananda who? He was also a renowned person. And one of the associates, not only associate, very
intimate
associate. And he has to. We should try for that is sannyasi. He should come. Really the relation. And relations should come one pointed to Krishna. Otherwise, he should be in grihastha life, supporting and nursing them and being able. So we should always remember. I wanted to tell so many things, but I want to hear also. You should speak, sir. Also, I am very cruel in this matter. If I will hear anyone having any connection, I am going there. I will take their sannyas and everything, saffron cloth, and I will give name or like that. Dasadhikari. Let's wait in 15 minutes.
Open one or two windows there.
On the top only, not like this.
Om Ajnana Timirandhasya Jnananjanashalakaya Chakshur Unmilitam Yena Tasmai Sri Gurave Namaha. Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prishtaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Namaha. Vancha kalpatarugascha kripa sindhu genacha patitana pavane bhyo vaishnavi bhyo namo namaha. Srila Prabhupada Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur. He is the, like the engineer of this modern Krishna consciousness movement. Srila Sachidananda Bhaktivinoda Thakur, he was like the architect. He designed the whole plan. He wrote all of the directions, all of the shastras. And he called for the Supreme Lord Sri Krishna and Srimati Radhika to send their dearmost servitor, their empowered servitor to this world to execute this great mission and to bring Krishna consciousness movement, the mercy of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, to the length and breadth of the entire world. Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur first of all wrote one book in English language, and this was Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, His Life and Precepts. And he sent this book to the Western countries, into universities in Canada and England. And in this way, he began this flow. Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur's movement, it is called Bhaktivinoda Dhara, like a stream, a transcendental stream of nectar flowing down from Srila Rupa Goswami Pad and Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And as we heard, without the presence of these divine personalities in this world who strongly preach the message of Mahaprabhu and completely smashed all misconceptions of the Apasampradayas and Mayavad misconceptions that were so prevalent at that time, without their coming, it is sure and certain that this Krishna consciousness movement would not have come to the Western world, and even more, it could have disappeared or gone underground within the land of Bharata. But by the mercy and the divine empowerment of these personalities, today we are sitting here. None of us could be here if it was not for the mercy of Srila Sachidananda Bhaktivinoda Thakur and his divine representative, Srila Prabhupada Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur. So actually, how have we received this mercy? How has it come to us? Because Srila Prabhupada, from the first meeting with Srila A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, from the first meeting of this divine personality in 1921, when he was young man and householder and coming to his lotus feet for the first time to hear him speak the message of Gauravani. Then as soon as he arrived there with some other classmates of his, university classmates, and paid his obeisances to this sadhu, the very first words that he heard from him was that, oh, you are all intelligent Western persons. You should preach this message of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu to the whole world, to the English-speaking world. It will be good for you. And then at that time, Abai Charan Day, at that time, he objected. He gave some argument that, how is it possible that we can preach and distribute this message of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu? Who will listen to us in the world? We are a dependent nation. We are ruled by another country. So who will listen to us? What kind of voice will we have? And then at that time, Srila Prabhupada, he defeated Abai Charan Day. And he told him that this message of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is not dependent upon any political situation, who is ruling, which party is ruling, which country is ruling. It is completely transcendental. So in many ways, he defeated him. And then Abai Charan Day at that time said, I very much was so pleased to be defeated by my Guru Maharaj. And from that moment, he accepted him. He told, I accepted him in my heart as my Guru Dev. And he left that place thinking, now the movement of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, it is in the hands of a very great personality, very qualified personality. So years later, he also sent one letter just before the disappearance of Srila Prabhupada And he asked him that, I am one of your disciples. You have many thousands of disciples. I am a householder and I cannot do service like you have so many brahmacharis and sannyasis. So what can I do? What service can I do for you? And then Srila Prabhupada wrote back to him. And he said it was the same message that he had gotten 12 or so many years before in 1921 at their first meeting. He told him, he said that you should always try to preach this message in the English language and without any kind of difficulty, you should try to print books. Whenever you get any money, you should try to print books and distribute to the world. So by these orders of Srila Prabhupada, by the divine inspiration coming from him into the heart of Abhai Charan Day, he carried out this order of his Guru Maharaj, and by his mercy, he came across the oceans to reach the whole Western world with the message of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So we should understand, like Gurudev told this morning, that he is like an arm, an extended arm of Srila Prabhupada Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati. It was him who was doing this preaching work, who had given his mercy to all the fallen souls throughout the world, whose heart was breaking to give this mercy and this line of Bhakti Vinod Dara to the whole world. It said, and Abhai Charanaravinda, who became Srila Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, he brought this message to everyone by the empowerment of his Gurudev. And also by the empowerment of the most intimate servitor of his Gurudev. Srila Nityalila Pravishta Om Vishnupad Sri Srimad Bhakti Pragyan Keshav Goswami Maharaj, who was his dearmost bosom friend and who empowered him by giving him sannyas order and making him to drink the nectar of bhakti rasa, vairagya yug bhakti rasam prayatnaya. And by the empowerment and mercy of these divine personalities, Srila Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj was able to go to the length and breadth of the world and to bring thousands and millions of people to the lotus feet of Mahaprabhu and Radha and Krishna. So who was this exalted divine personality who came within this world by the calling of Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur? He was direct associate of Radha and Krishna in transcendental Sri Vrindavan Dham and a personal associate of Sri Gauranga Mahaprabhu. And his whole life was simply a complete manifestation of his highly exalted position, as we heard this morning from Gurudev, so many indications in his very childhood. And we heard also from the lotus mouth of our Gurudev, Srila Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, how his Prabhupada had such an exalted nature and qualities, and how powerful he was. He used to tell that my Guru Maharaj was hard like a thunderbolt, but also he was very soft like a rose. So his Vaishnava qualities were so exalted that Bhajanorajita Sajjana Sangha Patim, that even the most exalted personalities, the most highly elevated transcendentalists, oh, they want his association. They are worshipping his lotus feet. So I want to tell how Srila Prabhupada Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati, in his youth, there are so many beautiful stories in his biography about his manifesting his divine character. But one particular history tells of one time when he was in his youth and he was in his teens. We heard this morning that already he was very, very renowned and he was so highly exalted in the science of astrology. But also, he was vastly, vastly learned in all the shastras. And it so happened that at that time, there was a very great challenge which had come from the Brahmana, especially the smart Brahmana community, that was prevalent around Navadvip Dham area at that time. And they made a challenge to the Gaudiya Vaishnav community that everywhere it is stated in the Shastras that Krishna, the Supreme Lord, is more favored to the Brahmanas. Namo Brahmanya Devaya Go Brahmana Hitaya Cha. That he is always favoring the Brahmanas, even more above the Vaishnavas. So this challenge came, and many of the exalted Vaishnavas in Navadvip Dham, they elected that Srila Sachidananda Bhaktivinoda Thakur would come, and he would present all of the evidence of Shastra, and he would defend all of these bogus accusations coming from the smart Brahmana community. But at that time, Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur was bedridden, and he was manifesting the lila of being sick. So he told, to his dearmost disciple and son.
I want to tell you that you told that Krishna is Go Brahmanditaya, and he has given more importance of Brahman than Vaishnava. Where? Any example?
बता रहे हैं स्मार्ट लोग ये भावना लेकर के अटैक कर रहे थे वैष्णवों के ऊपर
स्मार्ट लोग का ये विचार बता रहे हैं वैष्णवों का नहीं है दैट
वाज द आइडिया ऑफ समाज और
Smart. No, smartest idea. Yes.
Then okay.
Yes, yes.
So, but anyway, whole Bengal or whole India was suffering from in these days.
Yeah.
A smart Brahman. They wanted their influence.
So then, Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur gave him the order that he should go, even though he was still in his youth, but he had full confidence in him that he would be able to go there and present perfectly the final conclusions of all the Shastras to prove that Krishna is always favoring the Vaishnavas over the Brahmanas, and that a pure Vaishnava, he is automatically a Brahmana. But a Brahmana is not automatically a Vaishnava. So, then at that time, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Prabhupada, who was known as Siddhanta Saraswati at that time, he prepared one amazing essay, which actually now, it has been translated, that same essay has been translated into English language. And all of the quotations which he gathered from so many different Shastras to support his conclusions are all mentioned there in this book. Very, very vast essay that he wrote. So, with empowered with this essay and armed with this ammunition, he now went to this meeting in Medinipur. So, at this assembly, the Brahmanas were seated on one side. So the Brahmanas were seated on one side.
He did not went, but he was sent by Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur.
Yes. He was deputed by him. So, on one side were the Brahmanas, and on the other side were the Vaishnavas. In that gathering of Vaishnavas, there were also many exalted personalities revered amongst the Vaishnava community. But they had chosen Siddhanta Saraswati as the presenter of all of this pure Gaudiya Vaishnav Siddhanta. So, the director of the assembly, he had given chance to the Brahmanas to present their arguments. And so, they had spoken for a very, very long time, those who were representing the Brahmanas. And they had presented so many different evidences from the Shastra. So now, at the end of that evening, then they adjourned, and then the next day, again they began. But now they gave chance to Siddhanta Saraswati and the Vaishnava side to begin to present all of their evidence. So now, Siddhanta Saraswati, he began, first of all, to present all various quotations from the Vedic Shastras about the exalted position of the Brahmanas. So many different quotations he gathered from everywhere in the Vedas, Upanishads, in Mahabharata, in so many different places. And he presented a very, very powerful presentation, so much so that it practically appeared that he was stating that the Brahmanas were in the superior position. So he spoke for many, many hours like this. And as he was speaking, the Brahmanas who were on one side, they became very happy. They were very encouraged. And they thought, oh, very nice, he's supporting our side. So he spoke till the end of the day. Then, again, they had to resume the next day. So, in the early morning time, again he began to speak. And now, he began to present from the Shastras so many powerful evidences and quotations which superseded all the quotations that he had made about the Brahmanas and directly showed that the Vaishnava is superior to a Brahmana
and a Brahmin. Really, who is Brahmin?
And a Brahmana is not by birth. So many statements from Shastra explaining that in Kali Yuga there is no pure birth lineage, and in Bhagavad Gita Krishna says Chaturvarnya Maya Shistam Guna Karma Vibhagasha, that all of the divisions of the four varnas and ashramas, they are not determined by birth but by quality, guna, and by karma, by work. So in this way Srila Prabhupada Saraswati Thakur, he began to glorify the position of the Vaishnavas. And as the Vaishnavas were hearing this, they were feeling so much happiness. And the whole crowd, there were thousands of people who were assembled there for this great debate. And everyone was beaming. And so finally he spoke all the way through the entire day. And at the end of his whole session, those who were making the judges of the debate, they unanimously decided in the favor of Siddhanta Saraswati that he had perfectly presented these arguments and thoroughly represented the position of Shastras and firmly established that the Vaishnava position is superior to the Brahman's position.
This morning, we heard from the lotus lips of Srila Gurudev about the divine and uncommon appearance pastimes of Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur, and about his uncommon childhood. And we have heard from the perspective of a loving father, Srila Bhakti Vinod Thakur, how he was somewhat worried about his son, how he tried to find some engagements for him in this world, but at every step he failed because his son had too much devotion. He failed in his chemical business, his Ayurvedic business. He failed in his teaching business. Every place he felt. So finally, Srila Bhakti Vinod Thakur acquired land in Mayapur and deities there, and he began to serve the deities there. So Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur, from his childhood, he was so devoted. We have heard how his father in his childhood gave him the mantra to Kurmadev. He did not give him mantra to Radha and Krishna. Why? Because he wanted to manifest within this world a very wonderful pastime. The pastime of Srila, this Bimal Prasad, taking shelter of the lotus feet of Nityalila Parvishnam Vishwapad Sishimad, Gaur Kishore Das Babaji Maharaj. Even though Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur was the most learned scholar in the whole of India. He was learned in all Veda, Vedanta, Upanishad, Vyakaranam, Sanskrit. He was the most learned person in astrology even. That the dean of the college, Calcutta University, kept open a seat for him there, that he should be head of the astrology department. So from the material perspective, he had all types of qualifications even. But what happened? He was very much attracted to the lotus feet of Srila Gaur Kishore Das Babaji Maharaj. Srila Gaur Kishore Das Babaji Maharaj had come from a very simple family. In his Purva ashram, he was a grain merchant. And upon the passing away of his wife, he accepted Babaji Vesh and he came to Navadvip and was doing bhajan there. He had no education, it seems. It seems that he could not even write his own name. And now, the most learned scholar in the whole world came to him and begged him, please accept me as your disciple. I want to accept you as my Gurudev. Please accept me. But Srila Gokishodas Babaji Maharaj said, no. You are the son of Srila Bhakti, the great personality Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur. You are from a very high class Brahmin family. And you have a very great education.
No, he did not told like this. Brahmin family, he never told.
He said, oh, he did not say you are from Brahmin Vaishnav family.
Vaishnav family.
Vaishnav family. You are from great Vaishnav family. And you are very educated. So, you should not accept me as your spiritual master. He begged again and again. He said, I will ask Gauranitai. Srila, that time Bimal Prasad, he went away and then came back. Will you accept me? Oh, I forgot to ask Gauranitai. In this way, Srila Gaurakishodas Babaji Maharaj made so many excuses. So finally, Bimal Prasad, Siddhanta Saraswati, he went away and he was doing Chandrayan Vrata. This is a very difficult vow in which the person on the full moon day can take 15 bites of food and then the next day 14, the next day 13 and down on the Astami only 8 bites and then 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, then fasting and then again they can increase. So according to the cycle of the moon, they control their eating and Siddhanta Saraswati was becoming very, very thin and sick, not taking by hand, only by eating like a cow from the ground with the mouth. So at that time, Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, he requested Gokishodas Babaji Maharaj, just see how this boy is so determined to take shelter of your lotus feet. And just see how he's becoming very lean and thin. It is as if he is about to die. He's very sincere. And on the inspiration of Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, then Srila Gokishodas Babaji Maharaj accepted and initiated him and gave him the name Sri Barsha Banavi Devi Daita Das, the servant of Srimati Radhika. So the question may come, why is it that the most learned person and qualified person from such an aristocratic family will take shelter of this person who seems to not have a very great background? Oh, the answer is that the disciple does not approach the guru for any position in this world. In his humility, Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur said, when I came to my guru, I had so many false egos, thinking that I was a great scholar, I was a great aristocrat. In his humility, he said, but my Gurudev, by his causeless mercy, he sprinkled the dust from his feet upon my head. And at that time, I became unconscious, unaware of all of these things by his causeless mercy. Because when the disciple approaches the lotus feet of Sadhguru, he does not come for any kind of prestige, power, position, or material education. But rather, Srila Gokishodas Babaji Maharaj had what Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur was searching for. What is that? He was always weeping. Radhe, 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 Jai 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 Sri Radhe, 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 Jai 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 Sri Radhe. Vrishva Bhanu Nandini Radhe, Radhe,
Vrishva Bhanu Nandini Radhe, Radhe,
Bhagavana Namohi Radhe, Radhe. Srila Gokishodas Babaji Maharaj himself would sing. He had the inspiration in his heart to manifest this kirtan in the world, in which the mood of Raghunath Das Goswami has been expressed. Kote go prema mai radhe radhe, O Srimati Radhika, where are you? Go sai niyam kore sadai dake radhe radhe. Raghunath Das Goswami is always crying, O Srimati Radhika, where are you? Malin vasan diya gai radhe radhe, giving up his worldly, royal attire of being a wealthy person and putting on the gray cloth covering the dust, just ordinary, dirty white cloth. Malinvasadiya Gai Radhe Radhe, Braje Dulai Gadagadi Jai Radhe Radhe. With his voice choked, he would roll on the ground in the pain of separation from Srimati Radhika. Mukhe Radhe Radhe Bole Radhe Radhe, Bose Nayanera Jale Radhe Radhe. Always calling out the name of Radhika and drowning in the current of his own tears of separation. So Srila Gaurakrishnadas Babaji Maharaj was like this. And upon seeing this, that Bimal Prasad, seeing this, a greed came. And he thought, I want to have a mood like you. This is the reason why we approach the lotus feet of Sri Guru. Not for anything else. Only for this mood of deep love and separation from the lotus feet of Radhika. That one day we may attain her service. And in this way, he took shelter of his Gurudev. And in 1905, at the age of only 31, he took shelter of the Chandrasekhar Bhavan in Mayapur Dham and began to observe his vow to chant 1 billion names. 1 billion names of Radha and Krishna. That means to complete 3 lakhs Harinam, 192 rounds every day for 10 years. So he began his vow and he was completely absorbed in Nam Bhajan and reading the books of our Goswamis. At that time, Srila Gaurakrishnadas Babaji Maharaj, he commented, oh, I can see the Vairagya of Das Goswami in my Prabhu. He would call his disciple my Prabhu. And he said, I see the Vairagya, renunciation of Raghunath Das Goswami in him. It was at that time when Srila, Barshabhanavi Devi Daita Das, he wrote his commentary on Shikshastakam, Manashiksha, and Sri Chaitanya Charitamritam. These commentaries on Manashiksha and Shikshastakam, very mercifully Srila Gurudev has translated and presented to us. So that we can see the method by which Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Sasari Thakur was doing his bhajan and his deep realization of the Siddha Pranali, that is the Shikshastakam of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and the Manashiksha of Srila Raghunath Das Goswami. But in the year 1914, Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur discovered his unmanifest pastimes. He left the vision of ordinary mortals in this world. And shortly after, in 1915, Srila Gaurakrishnadas Babaji Maharaj also departed from this world. Now, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Sasari Thakur was in this world apparently without the association of his nearest and dearest, his Diksha Guru, Srila Gaurakrishnadas Babaji Maharaj, and his Shiksha Guru, and all in all, the lotus feet of Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur. What to do now? Vaishnavism was in a dark period. So by the inspiration of his Diksha Guru and Shiksha Guru, he took sannyas and he began his preaching. But in what way did he preach? Previously other Vaishnavas, other Acharyas, they had spread the glories of their Siddhanta by taking patronage from a king or a powerful person. But Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Sasari Thakur, just taking the help of some very young teenage boys who had left their homes and everything, he gave them sannyas and with them he began to preach everywhere. And in the beginning they had nothing. At that time when Vinod Bihari Brahmachari, Param Gurudev, Srila Bhakti Pragyan Keshav Goswami Maharaj, Paramananda Prabhu and others came, there was nothing. Gaudiya Math meant that Paramananda Prabhu would the offer artik and Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Sasari Thakur would ring the bell only. Narahari would offer artik and Paramananda Prabhu would ring the bell. And this was Gaudiya Math. There was nothing. They were so poor. They had nothing to eat. They would pick some weeds from the jungle and boil them and eat them. And if Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Sasari Thakur would notice that they had nothing to eat, they would tell, oh Gurudev, we are practicing Vairagya. They would not bring any bad news into the ear of their Gurudev. Because Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Sasari Thakur inspired within them so much faith and devotion in the lotus feet of Sri Guru and in the service of Gauranga, that tolerating all difficulties and in a very humble and simple way, they began the preaching. And very soon, only within a few years, it began to spread all over India, everywhere. And mats began to come and thousands of disciples came to Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Sasari Thakur. because his teachings were astonishing. He would tell the people, don't try to see Krishna. Try to behave in such a way that Krishna will want to see you. This is the method of self-realization. He told them, oh, you cannot enter into transcendental bhajan by imitation, by imagination, any more than a woman can give birth to a child by going into the hospital, lying on the table in the maternity ward and making sounds like a woman in labor. Can she give birth? Quite impossible. So by imitation is not possible. You have to serve lotus feet of Guru. Anatanya Vritti will have to go on. Nishta, then taste, ruchi, asakti, attachment. And then one can enter into internal services of lotus feet of Radha and Krishna. He preached very boldly all of these things and established the pure Vichadhara of Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur. That means the pure teachings of Rupa and Raghunath. In 1924, on this day, his birthday, he arranged for Vyasa Puja, the worship of the whole Guru Parampara. And at that time, he gave a very astonishing speech. All the disciples and many others had come and worshipped him with many presentations of flower garlands and donations. Then, seeing that there were some people in the audience who could not recognize his position or understand the meaning of Guru Seva, hearing what they were whispering in their hearts, he gave a lecture. And in that lecture, he explained that there are some people here who are thinking, who is that person sitting up on a big high seat accepting all of this worship when many learned and respectable personalities are seated upon the ground? What kind of animal from a zoo, what kind of brute can sit there proudly on a big seat while others are sitting on the ground? Then to you, I give this answer. You know that a Vaishnav will never accept the position of Guru. Vaishnav, this thought will not come in his mind, I am Guru, because Vaishnav is Trinada Pisuni Chaina Torori Vasishtana, more humble than a blade of grass. So Vaishnav will never think, I am Guru. Yet on the other hand, unless a Vaishnav accepts the position of Guru, then the transcendental family will come to an end. The Sampradaya will not go on. So then what will he do? So Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Sahasrara Thakur, he explained that at the time of Rasa Leela, when the gopis were searching for Krishna, at that time they began to weep. Chuta piyala panasasana ko vidara bilvaka jamba bakula kadamba nipa yenge parata bhavaka yamunopakula samstantu Krishna padavim rahitatmanam naha. The gopis were searching for Krishna on the bank of Jamuna and they were approaching the trees. Chuta piyala panasasana kovidara. O kovidara tree, O mango tree, O jambu tree, bakul tree, O banyan tree. They're asking the trees, have you seen Krishna? Because you live on the bank of Jamuna, you live in this holy place, then you are sadhus and you are very merciful to others. So please be merciful to us and tell us, where is the son of Nanda Maharaj? Because he has taken our hearts and he has run away. So gopis of Vrindavan having the highest prem, then they see even the trees and creepers and flowers of Vrindavan to be like their guru. So similarly, the Mahabhagavat Vaishnav, he never sees that he is guru, but rather he sees that everyone is his guru.
Vajin Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Similarly, so many acharyas came to India. Shankaracharya, Ramanujacharya, Madhvacharya, Vishnu Swami, Nimbadita, Vallabhacharya, so many came. After that, see, Sarup Damodara Raya Ramananda, Sada Goswami, Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami, up to Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur. But all the ideals were included in Srila Prabhupada. What proof Goswami? Okay, you heard something from Aranya Maharaj, from Raghunath Das Goswami. He took sannyas by process from Ramanujacharya. He did not talk from Nityananda Prabhu and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu because they were ek dandi. And that is why Chaitanya Mahaprabhu broken in three pieces. And three pieces, three dandas. So he followed this process from Ramanujacha. And Madhvacharya, O five Siddhants, Jivishware Bhed, Jive Jive Bhed, Jiv Jade Bhed, Jade Jade Bhed, Jade Vishware Bhed. But then Vidya Bhushan has told all these things. So Prabhupada, in Prabhupada, all these things were there. Or Guru Maharaj used to tell that Ramanujacharya, Madhvacharya, especially Shankaracharya, Madhvacharya and others, they took help from big, big kings, very powerful and wealthy personals. So many, like Buddha Dev,
by
Ashok, Shankaracharya by so many. Ramanu, so many big, big wealthy persons of South India. Madhvacharya same. But Prabhupada, what did? Miracle. He told to his disciples, oh, I'm giving one very small box. You should go to door to door in a station, a railway station, bosses, in markets, everywhere, and tell them to give one spice only, don't take two. And tell them what is Krishna Bhajan. Go door to door and tell them after so many species you have become human, one day you will die. You cannot take your even a hair or body anymore. So, please chant Hare Krishna. Take shelter of a bona fide guru. So go door to door. And what became? Very soon in whole Bengal or whole India, even he sent in his lifetime, one Maharaj, Sri Bhakti Pradeep Tirtha Maharaj, Saranga Goswami Maharaj, to Western country, especially in England, Germany to here. So, he was very kind, very bold. So, all the ideals of the whole previous acharyas were in Sridhar Prabhu, some special also. He was bold, but very high class of darshani. But even waiting, like he told in Jagannath Puri Chatak Parvat, here and there. Once he was in Radhakund, and big parikrama was there, more than 500, 600 or 1000. And there he told the same word you told. In the exhibition and so many things, he told, I came to this world. I began to cut the jungle of Mayabad, Sahajiya, Sakhi, Bhegi and all others, Bodhavad also. And my whole life went away in this way. But you should remember, this is not the aim and object of our life. To be the maid servant of the Lord's feet of Srila Rupa Goswami. Always remember how to receive the service of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Sachinandan Gaudhari and Radha Krishna Kanjuga. For this Nityananda Prabhu came, for Baldev Prabhu came. So please remember, cutting jungle and all other things that I have done It was necessary for to establish that thing. So don't be so much engaged in this. Always remember our aim and object to have love and affection for Radha Krishna. Otherwise you will be karmi. Karmi. He has written in Gaudiya magazine, it is written. So, we should also try to work what we are doing, establishing press, publishing books, Gaushala, medical helps, Gurukul, etc. But you don't invest your whole time in that. You should try to know the aim and object that I told for today, yesterday especially. This is our aim and object. Also, he used to tell my Guru that Srila Prabhupada has a special mercy to Jiva. He never told anyone, disciple or anything. Oh, Ramananda. Oh, this. Prabhu. He was so humble. Very humble. He quoted that, told that at the time of Vyas Puja he told so.